Well, in the respiratory system, there are a lot of similarities between the cardiovascular and the respiratory system. In the cardiovascular system, we have a pump, that's the heart. In the respiratory system, we also have a pump. It's not the lung. Lung is the airbag. It's the diaphragm, mainly the diaphragm, and also the muscle help breathing. In the cardiovascular system, we have the fluid, that's the blood, flow in, flow out. In the respiratory system, we talk about air flow. In the cardiovascular system, we spend a lot of time talking about how to regulate the blood flow by constrict, dilate the blood vessel. In the respiratory system, we will constrict and dilate the airway, the bronchial, and to regulate air flow in and flow out. In the cardiovascular system, you have a big surface area in the capillary for gas and nutrient exchange. In the respiratory system, you have a lot of alveoli, those small air bubbles in the lung for gas exchange. Your respiratory system can be divided into the upper respiratory and the lower respiratory system. The upper one includes the mouth, the nasal cavity. You can use your mouth and your nose to breathe. Pharynx is a fancy word to say throat. And the larynx is your vocal cord. Your lower respiratory system, including the trachea, the bronchi, the bronchial, and the lungs. These slides show you to successfully breathe, you require four processes. Before you take this class, you think breathing is bring the oxygen from the outside into your lung. That's just the beginning of breathing. After that, the oxygen is delivered to your blood. So in your lung, you have millions of alveoli. Each one have a capillary waiting there. The oxygen delivered to the blood. Then it's your cardiovascular system's job to send the blood to your tissue. When you go to the tissue, and the oxygen need to load to your cell, and it's your cell need to use the oxygen to produce ATP. That's what makes your cells happy. You can block breathing in every different step. In next chapter, we'll talk about the breathing disease. You can block the air here, or here, or here, or here. And they have similar effect. Your respiratory system have the conducting zone and exchange zone. So let's use next slide to explain it. The conducting zones are the pipes. So larynx, trachea, the bronchi. And this slide shows you more detail, the conducting zone. They look very similar to the tree. If you think about the tree in front of your house, you have one big trunk divided to two big branches, and they divide again. And you reverse the tree, that's your respiratory tract. Start from one trachea, and it will divide to two primary bronchi, and it will divide again, secondary, tertiary. The pipes become smaller and smaller, and the number exponentially increase. When they reach the bronchial and alveoli, you have millions of them. And because you have millions of them, they can increase the surface area. That's where we call this exchange zone, the end of the bronchial. We call them respiratory bronchial and alveoli. That's where the gas exchange happens. And you have millions of them. So total surface area in the lung is about a half tennis court. It's about 1,200 square feet. This slide shows you in the lung, you have millions of alveoli. These are the small air bubble for the gas to exchange. And each alveolus have the capillary waiting there for the gas exchange to happen. In the alveoli, That's where the gas exchange happens. And gas goes from the lung into the blood through simple diffusion. That's the mechanism we talk about in Unit 1. Simple diffusion depends on the distance. The shorter distance, the better. Diffusion works pretty well for short distance, not so well for the long distance. So the cells in the lung, they use the pretty thin cells. We call them squamous, flat, squamous epithelium. And it only has one layer, so it's called the simple squamous epithelium cell. If you put bigger cell, more layers, you are asking for problem. And that's when the lung disease happens. In next unit, when we talk about the fibrotic lung disease, you turn the lung tissue into scar tissue. You make this thick, and it will compromise gas exchange. So over 95% of the cells, they are type 1 epithelium cells. They are simple squamous epithelium cell. And you have about 5% of them that are type 2. Type 2 alveolar cells, they secrete surfactant. Surfactant is like oil, it's made of cholesterol. The function of surfactant is to decrease the surface area. So that's the lung alveoli. And it's like a balloon. If you want to extend it, you want to decrease the surface area, and that's surfactant's job. Surfactant will cover the inside of the alveoli and decrease the surface area. Decrease the surface tension, and it's easier to expand the lung. And surfactant, these cells, type 2 alveoli cells, mature pretty late. They mature in the third trimester of pregnancy. The reason is the first time you start to use your lung is after you are born. And you breathe, you breathe, you make the air flow in, flow out of your lung. And that's the first time you start to use your lung. So there's no reason for the type 2 alveoli cells to mature too early. But it creates a problem for premature baby. For premature baby, if they were born too early, they may face the risk, which is that type 2 alveoli cells are not mature yet, so they don't have enough surfactant. And when they don't have enough surfactant, it's difficult to extend these alveoli. Their lung can collapse, and they can suffocate to death. So it was a problem in the mid-20th century. But now we have the artificial surfactant, so that problem is fixed. It's made of cholesterol. So we have more and more successful cases to bring those premature baby back. This slide shows you in the lung is covered by a double membrane structure. So these are the alveoli. Now let's look at the double membrane structure called pleural membrane. So the lungs, the heart, they're covered by a double membrane structure. So the heart is called the pericardial membrane, and the lungs are called the pleural membrane. And they have the double membrane structure is to reduce the friction. So every time your heart work and your lung breathe, they won't rub against each other. And the second one is this double membrane we will talk about today. We'll talk about the pressure. Inside is a little bit negative pressure. And this negative pressure keeps the lung extended. It helps the lung extend it. So the cavity, we actually call it the pleural cavity. It covers the lung. If you imagine the lung is a balloon, this is the lung. And or if you think this is your fist, you squeeze it into a balloon. This balloon will completely cover your fist. And that's the structure of the pleural membrane. So that's your lung, and that's the pleural membrane. They become two layers, one cover the lung, one cover the outside. Okay, let's take a break.